Stephen Holt, and guess what? We're back in Provincetown! Yay! Once again, we're back in Provincetown for the Provincetown International Film Festival. There's going to be so many stars, as you know. Otherwise, why would I be here? Well, I'm here because Provincetown is just magic. There's magic in the air no matter what color the clouds are. Gray skies are always blue to me. And Provincetown, look at this. These boats here, oh my God, are these tugboats or these regular, but these must be some kind of fishing boats. That's what they are, because that's all they do here. The seafood here is incredible. You're gonna see so many incredible restaurants, and the seascape is so beautiful. Aren't you all happy that you're not watching another show that I've shot in New York? It's just great, and the sun is beginning to set, although you can't tell today, but it is because the lights are starting to come on. It's twilight, and I'm so happy to be in wonderful, magical Provincetown again. I never want to leave when I come here, but I'm so happy I'm here now. Came by Amtrak, got on the ferry, which you just saw, and that's the way to come, by Bay State Cruises. And no matter how rough the seas are, once you get here, it's all smooth sailing at the Provincetown International Film Festival. Stay tuned. And now, how excited am I? I'm sitting here with one of the most beautiful women in the world. Oh my God, look at you. It's Vera, the glamorous, fabulous, brilliant Vera Farmiga, Academy Award nominee. Welcome to the Stephen Holt Show, Vera.
Thank you, Stephen. It's a pleasure to meet you.
You're one of our great actresses that we have around today on screen, and I'm a great actress slave. I just am. Most gay men are, because we appreciate quality and we appreciate women are doing it.
Thank you.
And you're really kicking it, because you're being honored for achievements in acting, I think, here.
It is, yeah.
Even though you just directed your first film.
Directed, yeah. No awards there yet.
but it's here. Your film was here, and I missed it. So you have to tell everybody all about it.
You have to see it. You have to see it. It's a weird...
I can't wait.
I hesitate to talk about that film because it...
we can say the name.
It's a film called Higher Ground. And it deals with a sort of very prickly subject matter of belief and faith,
okay.
Religious faith.
Which
is
stop there if
right.
you want.
Yeah,
because I have more news for you from that film. Guess who I just met in New York?
Who?
A couple of friends of yours.
Ooh.
Colleen Sharp.
Oh, how did you meet?
And
she's my editor.
Who was the other one?
Colleen's my editor.
The editor of, I just forgot, Malcolm Jameson?
Of Down to the Bone, yes.
Yes, at EditFest.
Oh, they're great.
And they both said, oh, please send Vera our love. And I said, I will.
That's so nice. Yeah.
Colleen and Malcolm.
Colleen was by my side. She was my editor for Higher Ground. And
we can talk about that.
Because she
said you had never gone into an editing room before.
Well, actors are barred from an editing suite. And just, I think, and rightly so. I mean, it's good to keep distance from...
But if you had a weekly cable television show, that's all you do is edit. So it's like, that's, I live in an editing suite.
Yeah. Malcolm edited Down to the Bone.
Yes. Malcolm Jameson. Lovely guy. Couldn't stop praising you. He said you would do anything to make a part real or successful. And I didn't see Down to the Bone either.
Deborah Granick was at the helm, and if you
Deborah
saw
Granick, it, right. Yeah, oh my God.
Yeah, she's a powerhouse. And I think she set the bar really for me. That was a really formative experience.
That's when we first knew you, and you won an award there.
She was at Sundance Film Festival.
And I didn't think you win the LA spot. Film Critics too?
Yes, I did.
See, the Oscar messenger strikes again. You're one of those Oscar magnetic actresses. One of these days, Vera. Yeah. One of these days. I can't wait to see Higher Ground. You could be in the mix.
I'm really excited for you to see, and I hope we can chat again more about
that. Well, please tell your press agent that I'll never stop talking to you forever. I'm madly in love now.
You're sweet,
and so beautiful. And you're here with, I think, we're getting off the subject of her movies.
My family?
I was going to say, you've got a family. Some actresses don't, you know.
Oh, yeah. You know, balancing that is pretty tough, as you probably
witnessed. Was aware. How many are there in your family?
There's only two for the
only
moment.
Two children.
I told my husband to pace himself.
Oh, okay.
I think he envisions a third. We both come from big families. I'm one of seven. He's one of seven.
Oh, uh-oh. You'll
have to alternate movies and kids and movies and kids.
Which is strange. I've been doing that. I mean, and it's funny. I've done more movies in the years that I've been pregnant than in years that I'm not pregnant.
Wow.
Yeah.
Little known fact.
Yeah. I think on years that I give birth, I average about 3 to 4 films that year. It's wild.
I also write for Awards Daily and sometimes uh-huh. Movie City News, and I remember reading, I think, in Movie City News or Awards Daily about how with Down to the Bone, which was your sort of catalyst film that catapulted you into recognition, you at one point rented a theater in downtown Los Angeles yourself. Is that true? To show it, or well,
I don't think so. I wouldn't have had any money to do that.
All right, well, then it's not true. Okay, somebody did. There was a showing,
and
they got the information wrong. Okay,
No, I didn't rent the space. I'm sure I got as many people to host for me as I could, any sort of celebrity that I could persuade to host on my behalf. They did, but no, I think that's Charlize Theron for Monster.
I don't know about that. I think it said Vera Farmiga, and there was a screening, and
the only way you can get word out, aside from, look, that film was very successful. Sorry,
don't lead out of the shot, Vera. Yeah, my heat will follow you though, rather than me, because the guest is everything on the Stephen Holt Show. They know what I look like. They know what I sound like. They want to hear from you. So you were saying the only way to get word out is by having Academy members see it or industry people see it.
Yeah, I mean, there's a fat chance they're actually going to stick it. Look, now I'm an Academy member, and I know.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And you get sent many, many discs and DVDs to look at.
It's unreal, isn't it? I'm not an Academy member, and I get sent them too. It's just like, what do I watch, you know?
Yeah, and it's interesting how even the marketing there and the strategy on behalf of producers and distribution companies
and
to get Academy members to see so I'm surprised Down to the Bone had LA Film Critics was a huge surprise. I had no idea that anybody besides eager film festival goers had seen that film. So the acknowledgement was
good on you, LA Film Critics.
Yeah.
They're particularly good at finding actresses that aren't, you know, household words, which you now are in many gay households at any rate. But of course, it was the absolutely opposite experience with Up in the Air.
Yeah.
Because that was handled by
Paramount was, and Jason Reitman, of course, had a certain measure of success with Juno and Thank You for Smoking. So there was a. And George.
Clooney. He helped. Yeah.
And George Clooney was going to be my dance partner. So they're automatically, I think, was
how
a big spotlight
were
on
you
that.
In that movie.
Thank you. He's fabulous to act.
And you were in The Departed, too.
And The Departed.
Best Picture. That helps.
Scorsese,
you are up there, Marty. You know. And now, with all of the acclaim and all of these wonderful, you know, high profile roles, you decided to direct.
I did. It took me
what
by surprise.
Happened?
It was one of these weird surprises. And it's because I was, honestly, I was knocked up around about the Oscars. And I knew I'd be down for the count for 9 months, so I thought I had to. Hi, Darren.
Aronofsky. Yeah, we're waiting him. He's waiting to talk to me. Go ahead.
So
Keep on.
I had to sort of figure out what I was going to do for the next 9 months, and I had been developing this film. Financing didn't come with whomever was at the helm at that point. So I think the more I've never developed a film from a script standpoint, and with this one, my own sensibilities came part of my own weird sense of humor,
I'm a screenwriter too and a playwright, so I know what you're talking about.
As I entered the equation, I wanted to defend the tone, especially because it was going to be a film that has a sort of the prickly backdrop of religion, which is an incredibly subjective subject, and I just wanted to defend that tone. It was a shorthand instead of telling someone what I envisioned for it. I just thought, let me tell the story.
Well, Colleen said you did a wonderful job.
Your
editor, Colleen
Sharp,
she said you were the best. So weird that I met all your editors. It's like
I had weird. Yeah, she saw. Well, yeah, I was also very hormonal. I was in my third trimester of pregnancy when we were editing the film.
Yikes.
We ordered, you know, there are moments of frustration in an editing room. It gets very emotional, the process, as you might know, what to keep, what not to keep, what gem that I'm throwing out, and how that doesn't feel.
I have to be as calm as I possibly can
when
I'm editing.
It gets really emotional. So the way we would deal with these moments would be, we'd be on eBay half the day, or, you know, or ordering, you know, we'd be on Mac.com ordering lipsticks and eyeshadow.
Oh,
you know, it was that kind of relationship.
Oh, okay.
I would have to remove myself completely, and like I'd go on an online ordering frenzy, as an outlet.
It changes you directing and editing, because you have to then.
It's an interesting perspective. It's really. And especially self-editing is maddening.
Well,
you have to look at it yourself and
vanity goes out the window the first thing.
Well, you've got to look, yeah.
So the story of this episode is me falling in love with Vera Farmiga, Academy Award nominee Vera Farmiga. Oh my God, Vera Farmiga. What is that?
Farmiga.
Farmiga with an R.
Farmiga. Farmiga.
What?
Ukrainian,
okay.
On both sides.
On both sides.
Although Farmiga it sounds Italian, or maybe even Portuguese. I don't know how that's
Russian, Ukraine?
Russia's next to the Ukraine, and
okay.
It used to be part of the Soviet.
Right, okay.
And Russia had control of the Ukraine for a long time, and Ukraine is now its own.
It's okay. And we are now out of time here with Vera Farmiga. But I'll see you soon, I hope, in New York. And hello for Malcolm, hello for Colleen, the unknown editors, people who do great, great work all the time and never get credit, you know.
Yeah.
So EditFest is a place where editors get together and they try to raise their profile. So here I am raising. Yes, it's like a film festival for editors. And I was there, and I was trying to make them all famous, too.
What's Malcolm Jameson been up to lately?
He told me, and I've completely forgotten, because all I can think about is Higher Ground and the Provincetown International Film Festival. But I'm sure he'd love to have an email from you, honey, if you got his email. You can find him. Anyway, thank you so much, Sean.
Lovely to chat.